by the Southern Sportsman Game and Seafood Restaurant, the best food from field and ocean. And by Long Haul Jeans, the most comfortable jeans you will ever wear.
Today, we will go for Ocean City flounder, hunt Ogeechee wild boar in Georgia, and cook merry old soul in the kitchen. It's been kind of interesting and actually entertaining to watch how things have changed at the restaurant since we opened it a little over 3 years ago. When you introduce recipes in an area, and I don't misunderstand me, there's some fine restaurants down in the eastern part of North Carolina, and they cook some mighty fine food. But we introduced a lot of different recipes when we first opened, and a lot of different foods. For instance, when we first started, it was very hard to even give away a frog leg, and that's how we had to start with frog legs. Not that many people down where we have the restaurant were devotees of fried frog legs. And we had them on the menu, and it got to the part to where Bobby Caraway, my partner in the restaurant, would send out, when he'd send out a meal, an order that somebody had sent for, he'd put one frog leg on there and just say, try this. And now we're just selling frog legs like crazy down there. People have really come to learn them. Merry Old Soul is another thing. When we first opened down there, the most popular thing on the whole menu was the fried seafood platter. And I love fried seafood, especially if you get it fresh. It's really great, but that was the big thing down there. And gradually, over this period of 3 years, it has reached the point to where we now sell more Merry Old Souls, the recipe that I'm going to show you right now, than we do sell a fried seafood platter. And to me, that's been kind of amazing. And also, I take a kind of a pride in it. Now, what I've got here is the makings of a kind of sandwich. I've got flounder, crab meat, scallops, shrimp. I'm chopping up the scallops right now. The shrimp I already chopped up just before you came here, and the flounder, of course, is the crab meat, of course, is shredded. And I'm going to make a kind of a sandwich. This, in a sense, is a sort of a stuffed flounder with some mighty fancy ingredients in it, except we're going to leave out the bones of the flounder. I've got some boneless fillets here and a small greased casserole dish. Now, what I'm going to do is just make an individual portion. You can do this, make them up individually if you want to serve four people or six people or however many you got, or you can get a big square casserole dish and do this all in one dish if you like. And just do what I'm doing and what I'm telling you to do, no matter what size it is, and have enough seafood to fill it up. Now, I take my chopped crab meat, about an eighth of a cup for an individual, and spread that in there on top of that first fillet. This is a little greased casserole dish. Bacon dish. Put that in there and then spread around some chopped shrimp, finely chopped up in little small pieces like this, and then also the scallops. Mix them all in there fine. And on this layer, I put some shredded mozzarella cheese. All righty, you with me so far? And I'm gonna salt and pepper here just lightly. The salt and pepper is not listed there on the recipe, but do salt and pepper it a little bit. Of course, you can do it later, it's okay. But I put a little salt and pepper on at this point. And then I take the other fillet and put that on top like this, and that caps the sandwich off, and spread hollandaise on it, hollandaise sauce, which you can get in the little dry packages and make, or you can go to any good cookbook. It'll have a recipe for hollandaise sauce, and you can make it at home. Either way is okay, but we just cover it all with hollandaise. And this is Merry Old Soul. And as I say, this has become the most popular dish that we now serve. And when we first started 3 years ago, people, of course, knew what stuffed flounder was, but they were just still a little bit, in other words, it wasn't baking and broiling country. It was fried seafood country when we started. And I take a little pride in the fact that we are not changing the people's taste down there, but we are introducing some new things that they like. And I've got a little paprika on top for color. The oven is set on 400 degrees, and I put this in, and I'll bake it about 15 minutes or something like that, 15 minutes, just until it's nice and tender and juicy all the way through and not overdone. Then I'll come back and sprinkle a little parsley on it, a little chopped parsley for garnish, and we serve it. And if you come to the restaurant, that's what you get, and it's delicious. Well, you can make it at home. It's just that simple and just that easy. It's just a little old flounder sandwich, and the goodie in the sandwich is crab meat, scallops, and shrimp. I'll be back here in a minute. We're going up to Ocean City first, and we're going to try for some flounder, and then we go into the swamps of Georgia for wild boar. All of that after these very important messages. One more thing about the Merry Old Soul. Of course, use the freshest seafood that you can get. That's not the tip, but the tip I want to give you in preparing it is let it sit a few minutes on the chopping block, and when you chop it up, and blot it so you don't have too much moisture in it. Now, it won't affect the taste of it, but sometimes if it's too damp, too wet, and hadn't had a chance to sit on the block and dry just a little bit and drain, it will be kind of soupy, and I like it firm all the way through, all the way down to the bottom. As I say, it won't affect the taste whatsoever, but if you get too much juice in there and you don't like it like soup, just if you do that beforehand, dry out whatever you got, the shrimp and the scallops and everything like that, a little bit on the chopping block, and let them drain before you mix them all together, you won't have that problem with it. It'll be nice and firm and absolutely delicious. As I say, it has become the most popular thing that we sell at the restaurant in the way of seafood. The duck is the most important thing, or the most popular thing that we sell on the game side of the menu. Well, we call that Merry Old Sole, but of course we make it out of flounder. Now, you don't get many sole in the United States. We think of Dover sole and the sole that you get in France. That is the famous worldwide sole. There are some sole that grow on the Atlantic side. They're a little different from the Dover sole, and they're also different from the common flounder, the summer flounder and the winter flounder that we get in this part of the country, but occasionally you run into one. They're kind of little square kind of things. And on the film I'm going to show you now, we caught two or three small sole while we were flounder fishing up at Ocean City, Maryland. Now, the flounder season really in Maryland starts in April, and the film I'm going to show you now was shot in middle to late April at Ocean City. Now, this is the big bridge, the causeway, and people catch flounder right off this bridge. You'll notice they've got a catwalk made there, and the fence that you see behind these people is not designed to protect the pedestrians or to protect the fishermen from getting run over or hit by a car. It's to keep the car from getting hit by flying lead. These people will make back casts and put a lead right through your window there because they're all excited and all fishing and everything. Ocean City is one of my favorite developed beaches. I'm not much on resort beaches, but I love to go to Ocean City when it's not in season. In other words, when school lets out, and then from then until Labor Day, there are just a few too many people there. Now, it's a marvelous, great, fabulous. I don't want to make my good friends in Ocean City mad or anything like that, but a quarter of a million people will be in there on a weekend, and I'm an outdoorsman. I make my living hunting and fishing, and it's a living that I enjoy. I enjoy hunting and fishing, but I love to go to Ocean City in April, and I love to go up there in October, November, when there are not quite so many folks, it's not quite so crowded. I'm one of these guys that bites his nails and gets frustrated in traffic. And if I go up there on the weekend in July, I know when I come back, my nails are going to be gnawed off to the knuckles of my palm. Now, we're going to fish today with two friends of mine, Jack Troutman. This is Jack catching one. He's a retired Pennsylvania game warden who now lives down there in Ocean City. And the guy in the back there, all bundled up with the sea captain's cap on, is Captain Bob Cooley, otherwise known in the Ocean City area as the Mad Russian. And we're fishing in his boat. This is the last week in April. And the flounder are fishing. Now, these guys are dedicated flounder fishermen. You notice that little rig he threw out there. They have a small sinker and only one dropper hook on it and a piece of strip bait, generally cut from another flounder. And they'll fish three or four rods apiece at a time. And they just lay them down and watch the tips of the rods. And when you get a little twitch on that rod tip, you're getting a bite. And their philosophy is, their theory is, by the time you walk over and pick the rod up, the fish has had chance enough to bite down. They advise beginners, they know better, but they advise beginners not. Now see there, see he's getting that first rod there is getting a little twitch there. By the time you get over it, he's had a chance to chew up on it. All too often, the guy who is the neophyte or the guy who is not, that's the rig that you see there, one hook. And by the way, the other boat that you see over there is another good friend of mine, Captain Barney Rowe, and he had a charter that day. He had a young lady who was fishing with him. But Bob Kulik and Jack Troutman are two of the best flounder fishermen I know, and they just have a touch. You'll drift through there, and you'll miss a lot of fish that they will not. Now, this is a sole. You see how kind of square looking he is? And this is the sole that they catch up there in that area. I haven't seen those down in the Carolinas and Georgia down through there. I think it must be a colder water fish, and we probably don't get them south of Hatteras. So we may not even get them that far. And this is what the bait looks like. It's just a thin strip of flounder belly cut. Well, we're in a place called a thoroughfare, back inside, behind the Ocean Beach area, behind the resort area. And you go in there and drift with the tide. There's a deep trench or ditch that drifts right along there in front of the houses. And you drift through it, and then you crank up, and you run back up the tide, so it'll bring you back through again. And when you do this in late April, you're going to catch fish. Now, you can charter these guys. Bob Kulick charters, and so does Barney Rowe. But when they don't have a charter, they love to go anyway. They just love to go out and fish. And I enjoy catching flounder. They're a lot of fun. And they eat mighty fine on the table, particularly when you make a merry old soul out of them. We kept 18 fish this particular day, and we were keeping them anywhere from about a pound and a half up to about 4 pounds. That guy's got a real nice flounder over there. He could throw that down on his bathroom floor and walk on it. It looks like a bath mat. I don't know what that fish went. He went like 6 or maybe 7 pounds. I don't know, but we're catching nice flounder here. This one will probably, and again, I'm guessing, you experts probably know more about it than I do, but I'd say this is about a 2-pound flounder here, maybe 2 1/4 or something like that. What do you think, guys? Well, if you don't agree, write me about it. I don't know. I'm not like a lot of these outdoor writers that can look at a piece of film and tell you what the fish weighs. And so I always try to underestimate a little bit if I have to, but there he is, and he's not a bad fish if you want to know the truth. That's a middle-sized cooler that we got there. Here's another sole that we're bringing in. And the little ones like this we were throwing back, but I wanted to film them because this is the first time I'd ever seen this particular fish, and Bob was pointing out to me it was a sole. Now, I may be all wrong. We may have them in North Carolina, but I've just never noticed them, never had one pointed out to me. This is what we normally get in North Carolina and South Carolina down in there, the kind that lays down flat on the bottom and takes on the coloration of the bottom. If he's on a shell bottom, he'll have spots on his back that looks like shells, so he's camouflaged. And he lies there, see, on that white side and the brown side up, and he's camouflaged against the bottom, and he just lies there on the bottom, and when the bait comes overhead, he rises up and snaps at it. That's why he's shaped the way he is and the way he's colored the way he is. That's the way a flounder makes a living all over the world. And that's the way they do in Ocean City. There's a lot of fishing in Ocean City, and April's a good month to go to Ocean City. If you go toward the end of April, and are lucky, last year, because of the water temperature and everything else, the Boston mackerel were a little late. And on that same trip that I went up there to catch the flounder, the Boston mackerel were still out there. Now, they come kind of early, generally about the middle of April. But if you catch the water temperatures and the weather and everything just right, you can get the flounder inshore, and you can get the mackerel offshore. And that's a hoot going out there and catching 4 and 5 of those mackerel at one time. I mean, it's really a lot of fun to drift through a school of them, the Atlantic mackerel or the Boston mackerel. And if you were watching a couple of weeks ago when I did my spring special shows for each of the 6 states, that's the one I did, was the Boston mackerel up there off of Ocean City for Maryland. I'll be back here in a minute. We're going down to Georgia and look after a very handsome brute, the wild feral boar. And all of that in just a minute after these very important messages. The pig or hog, I'm talking about the animal that we get the ham and the bacon and the sausage from and everything like that, is probably the most adaptable animal on the planet. He's probably a great deal more adaptable if you suddenly change his environment than man is. Considered to be highly intelligent for an animal, not as smart as man, or not as smart as a lot of us, but also very intelligent in the animal scale, and quite adaptable. In other words, they'll go wild and live in the wild in less than a generation, in just a few days or weeks. He'll take away his dependence that he has on the trough if you've been feeding him in the pen, and if he's broken out and hits the woods, he'll stay there. And he is quite adaptable and quite fearsome. He can make quite a trophy when you're hunting. He changes in the woods. He changes, he turns into a razorback. He gets thinner, leaner, grows longer tusks, And when he goes wild, he really goes wild. Well, I love to go and hunt them in Georgia. For one thing, you can hunt them after all of the other hunting seasons are over. You can go down there anytime. There's no closed season on them in Georgia. I don't like to hunt them in the dead of summer because it's just too hot and there's rattlesnakes out there and all those palmettos and swamps and everything else. But when it's still cool in April and May long in there, or in October, November, and the other seasons are not open, you can go down to Georgia particularly, but we have wild hogs in practically every state that I cover here in the Southern Sportsman Territory, North Carolina, West Virginia, everywhere you have hogs that have gone wild. I'm going to take you today down to Hall Brothers Lodge at Savannah, Georgia, where we're going to hunt a couple of different ways. Now, this is Jack Douglas, and he's holding one of the mounted boars and buck deer here, and the guy with him with the beard is Johnny Hudson. He's the cook there at the hunting lodge. Now, this is right below Savannah, Georgia, just a couple of miles down the road on U.S. 17 before you cross the Ogeechee River. And where we're going to hunt today is the Ogeechee River Swamp. Now, Johnny is a superb cook. He runs the lodge and he cooks there, and there's always some sort of a stew, a venison stew or a wild boar stew or a wild ham, something like that, and vegetables and everything. We're going out and hunt, as I say, the Ogeechee River Swamp. Now, you need two different kinds of dogs. This is dog hunting, and you need two different kinds to hunt wild boar. You need what they call a chase dog, and then you need what they call a catch dog. The chase dogs are muzzled, and they're just set loose. Now, the guy holding this dog on the leash is a friend of mine, Bruce Carter, who is with Channel 22, WJCL, down in Savannah, that carries the show. And Bruce is a good friend of mine. You've seen him here many times before hunting and fishing with me. He's just holding the dog to help Jack out. And the two hunters that we're with today are Joel Derringer from Cherryville and Gary Gregg from Shelby. And they wanted to get one boar. One of the guys had not collected his trophy to go on the wall, and he wanted one. So what we're going to do today is we're going to shoot one, but we're also going to catch one. Now, most of the places where we go, it's a lot of fun to run these things down and just catch them. You're talking about a 250 or 300-pound beast. And the thing you have to do, the reason the guys are running is those dogs got muzzles on them. They're trained to chase the boar, but they can't bite because they got the muzzle on. And so what you do is try to get there before the boar kills your dogs and put the catch dog on him. The catch dog is on the leash, and he's the one that grabs the boar by the ear or the snout and holds him until you do whatever it is that you're planning to do with the boar. But the boar will turn and kill the chase dog. Now, the reason they have muzzles is so they won't kill small pigs. In other words, it's big pigs, but here, that is the finish. There's a beautiful shot right over that one's shoulder and right into the heart when he came out of the water. And this is a 250, nice black wild boar, 250 pounds. And he'll make a great trophy, and this guy's got his trophy of a lifetime. He'll talk about this, but this is what drives you up a tree. Those upper tusks are called whetters, and the lower ones are the ones that really get you. They rub against the whetters, and the whetters keep the lower ones sharp. And they are sharp like razors. Now, while we were occupied with this boar, there was another boar that the dogs hit the trail, and I'm going to show you him, and it's called a blue boar. Now, blue boar is really a gray boar that has, under certain light conditions, his fur takes on a sort of a blue cast, and that's the reason they call him the blue boar. And he is the prize trophy of all. And Jack says, anybody want to shoot this one? And nobody did. Everybody said, no, we don't want to shoot him. Now, this boar here, he's just wondering what these dogs are all up to, and he says, I'm going to get me a dog here in a minute. And sure enough, when they turned the chase dog loose, the chase dog jumped right in on top of him. Now, all of a sudden, everybody's got to get in there and try to get the dogs back, because believe me, this boar can kill a dog right fast. We're going to catch this one. And Jack says, well, if nobody wants him, he'll make good breeding stock, and I'll take him over on the other side of the reserve, about 10 miles from here, and turn him out with all the lady pigs, not boars, but all the lady pigs. And we'll have some more small gray boars. So they bundled him up, shoved him in a truck, and they carried him over across the swamp, way on the other side where all the ladies live. And grays, they are free too. But over there, they feed them a little bit, and they don't bother him. They don't shoot over there or anything like that. Now, they're going to tag him, punch his ear and put a tag in so they can keep up with him. But this is what they consider prime breeding stock, and I think Jack was very pleased. Nobody wanted to shoot this boar. We had one, and that's all we needed. He's very upset, as you can imagine, because he's been thrown. He's been rudely assaulted by a pack of dogs, and he's been thrown rather unceremoniously in the back of a pickup truck. But we carried him over there. He's bigger than he looks here. He's bigger than you are. He'll weigh more than I will. This is a 250-pound or so wild boar. And you don't want to meet this guy out in the woods without some distraction. There are the ladies, and they'll leave him in the pen a few days until the ladies will get used to seeing him there, and he'll talk back and forth to them through the fence, and then Jack will go back and let him out, and he'll spend a little time over there, a little rest and recreation, a little R&R, and become good breeding stock, and Jack will look forward to having some more of those blue boars that go out and live in the swamp and go wild. I'll be back here in a minute with a final word after this. Merry old soul is done, and I just thought you might want to take a look at it. Now, you can make it at home if you do it like I tell you. It's delicious, or this is the way you'll get it down at the restaurant. We put a little parsley on it, and that's all there is to it. But it's really a delicious dish, and as I say, it has become the most popular thing we have on the menu. See you next week. Do yourself a favor. Take a kid fishing.